Hi, I'm Mara Webster with InCreative Company, and thank you so much for tuning into one of our talks today. We are a year-round talk series bringing you the best creative voices across film, television, theater, and entertainment. And today I'm so excited to be joined by the fantastically talented Susanne Bier to talk all about the HBO series, The Undoing. And the first thing that I wanted to dive into is it's so fun rewatching this series once you know the ending and you know all of the details and seeing how many minute details you've threaded in. I mean, even the very first scene where we have Hugh Grant in the show, he's talking about not liking dogs essentially. And at the beginning, we take it on face value. But when you rewatch his performance, you can see the undertones in it. And so I wanted to ask about the way in which you worked very specifically with Hugh to find those tiny cracks, those tiny glances across the room where he's letting us into his world, but we're not noticing it the first time round.
You know, it's so interesting you're saying that because I was hoping, I was kind of having this conversation with people because I was like, I think it might be really fun watching it twice, because it's essentially it's about kind of being truthful and yet trying to confuse audience a little bit. And so you kind of, you've had all those small things which supposedly where they talk about one thing and then, like you mentioned, like the dog or you know, the way they, for example, also the way they talk about Eleanor in the first episode. And the way he kind of, when you then see it second time, you realize that he's got like a small switch in his eyes and he's got things where you realize he's uneasy talking about her, but first time you just don't notice. And I think that was a lot of fun, and it was a very, very fine tune. I mean, for Hugh, it was like such a delicate balance, because you know, one step too much and, you know, and one step too little and it becomes a bit dull and sort of insignificant. So it was about kind of navigating that very, very, very fine balance. Yeah.
Yeah. And one of the visual elements that you employ throughout the series that everybody really attracted themselves to is the use of extreme close-ups. And I also think that's so interesting in the way that you use it, not only to give us an extreme piece of information where, you know, you come right in on Nicole's eye and we know exactly what her eye is thinking, but at the same time, it's a use of deception, because then we don't see the rest of her body language to know kind of how she's fully responding to something. And so I wanted to ask about the way that you use it. You use those extreme close-ups almost intentionally as a way of not giving us information, but making us think that you are.
you make me sound like I'm just all the time trying to deceive you. I'm not really. But the extreme close-up has a very interesting effect, because on the one hand, you feel you are in somebody's head. You feel you're part of somebody's mind. And on the other hand, there is a weird alienation taking place where you're kind of also, it's almost like you're looking at a landscape. So the face disappears and it almost like it becomes a white shot. And I find that kind of mix or that sort of illusion really fascinating. So you're inside and yet you're totally outside. And I think that makes you understand the character, because I think in a way the character feels a bit like that. You need to use it at times where there is that sort of intense confusion or intense desperation, or you can't use it just kind of frivolously.
Right. And with that idea of being inside and outside as well, I feel like the entire character of Eleanor is constructed in that way. And the way that Matilda performs that is so exquisite, because she has to give you such an immediate sense of who she is so that we connect to her, we care about her, we're emotionally invested in her journey. And at the same time, she has to remain this very elusive concept that exists mostly in people's minds throughout the series. So how did the two of you have conversations about the details that really needed to come forth for that emotional connectivity to the audience, and the ways in which she really needed to just exist as an enigma and an idea in our minds at the same time?
Look, she's super, super smart. And she had a very clear idea about that, about how to treat that, and about kind of, you know, also like, for example, first time, like when you see her at the party and there are all those men surrounding her, and you have that sense, I mean, she kind of balances the fact that this is a woman being very aware about her her sexual power, and yet being incredibly lonely. And so, and she kind of manages to do both at the same time. And I think that part of her enigma is the capability of that awareness of her, of being attractive, and then the painfulness of not really letting anybody know anything about her. And I think that that's what kind of makes it. And I think that that's what she's doing.
Yeah. And I love kind of the undercurrent of the play of dominance that she has over Grace. You know, when she comes up to her in the locker room and she's talking to her, she's almost playing a game and exerting a power, even though Grace has no idea that that's what's happening. Did the two of you think about that and an exertion of her power of dominance over this other character and this other woman?
I think, I don't know whether it's just that she's domineering. I think it's more that she's being provocative. I think it's more that there is a kind of, I mean, I will do whatever I feel like. But there's also, but at the same time, she's also obviously desperate. And Grace, Nicole Kidman's character, reacts to that. Grace has that sensitivity where she absolutely senses Eleanor's desperation and Eleanor's sort of, she's kind of weirdly crying out for help in that very provocative scene. And Grace senses that. And so I think there is a weird, weird understanding between those two women. It isn't just jealousy. It isn't just wanting the same man. I think there's also a weird compassion or a weird kind of feeling of being recognized in a strange way.
Mm-hmm. It's also interesting revisiting the scene with her and Jonathan, you know, when he is exerting violence over her. And the first time that he begins to exert violence, it almost feels like she's not completely surprised to see that side of him. Did you ever think that he had shown little elements of who he really was to her, that she had seen aspects of that in his personality before and that he'd let his guard down? Or did you construct it that he had kept this facade the same way that he did for everybody else in the show?
No, I think she had seen sides of him that other people hadn't. I think she had seen sides of him. I mean, he obviously hadn't been this violent, but I don't think that their relationship was a healthy relationship. I think, you know, just in its nature, I mean, she was deeply unhappy having had a son who was like a, you know, potentially fatally ill, and had fallen in love with the doctor. So that immediately put her in a very fragile position compared to him. And I felt, I mean, there's no doubt that part of their relationship was his extreme vanity, was his extreme feeling powerful towards that very, very sexy and very attractive and obviously vulnerable woman.
Mm-hmm. And when we look at the flashback sequences, when we see her, there's a lot of different tools employed. You know, there's moments where she exists as kind of this ethereal idea in Grace's mind. There's a moment where we actually see some of the footage of when she's being murdered very early on in the show. And then we later learn that that was actually what happened to her. You know, there's moments where you have kind of an anamorphic lens type look on her. So how did you think about the different camera setups that you wanted to have to convey these different emotional states of mind that Grace is experiencing? And did you also find yourself playing around with the placement of these in post-production a lot for different threads in how it feels?
Well, those kind of weird flashback with that lens, it's actually called like a lens baby. And it does sort of kind of slightly distort the center of reality, which is what we wanted. And, you know, is she real? Is she a figment of Grace's fantasy? And is what we're seeing a fantasy or is it real? And that was, you know, it's throughout the series, it's an attempt to sort of challenge and play with that perception.
Mm-hmm. I also enjoy a lot of the scenes where Grace goes walking and we get such a sense of her internal journey that she's taking in those moments, even though she's not interacting with anyone, she's not talking to anyone, she's not saying anything out loud. So how did you and Nicole work out what the different tones of those scenes were going to be so that it would give us such a sense of her internal journey?
Look, I mean, Nicole is a genius. So she kind of, she doesn't necessarily speak a lot about it, but then she walks and you go, whoa, of course. And she has a kind of like, there is a relentlessness to I want to say to definitely to Grace, but I suspect to Nicole as well, which is like, you know, there's no, I mean, she'll just do anything. Like she'll just, whatever that character might be doing, Nicole is just doing it. And so I think that doesn't really, I mean, I would love to, you know, say it was me. I think it's pretty much Nicole.
And you've spoken about how Nicole, you know, as an actor, gives you so many gifts as a director, because she'll try five or six completely different approaches when you're shooting any scene, which gives you so many possible options and different directions that you can take any scene or narrative thread in when you're editing. What were some of the ways in which you found different threads or emotional arcs for her character because of that?
Well, I think, you know, Nicole would have a scene and she would go, she would kind of play a scene and she would be very, very kind of hurt and upset. And then, you know, I would say, but you know, I think there's an anger here as well. And then you did, you know, you kind of went action. And then there was this kind of fury. And she didn't let go of the hurt. She just added the anger. And it was this kind of evolving thing of, I mean, it, every scene was kind of built very carefully, stone, like brick by brick by brick, and so which makes her weirdly, you know, in a way you totally get her, and in a way you totally comprehend her, and she's still enigmatic.
Mm-hmm. And is there a gift for you as a director having her on the project as a producer? Because when she steps on set to shoot a scene, she already knows, okay, what's the location? What's the setup going to be? What's going on throughout the entire day? Because she's been involved in a lot of those conversations already.
I think she makes a quite, you know, I actually think she makes a kind of blend wall between the different roles. And I think when she gets on set as a actress, that's what she does. She doesn't really do anything. I mean, because I think that that's why it works, because, you know, she's, as a producer, I can call her on the weekend and we can discuss certain things, but when she's on set and she's acting, she's not being distracted by other thoughts. She's totally present as an actress.
Yeah. I also think it's so interesting as a filmmaker that I think you're one of the only directors I've ever heard say that you love shooting out of order, because it gives you those unexpected moments that you may not have uncovered with something that happens later in the show, because you might have filmed it differently for the earlier scenes and not ever found that moment. Were there any moments in this series that were coming later in the show that you filmed earlier on that created that sense of an unexpected moment for you?
Oh, there were lots of it, but I want to say, I think in a way, you know, I think I don't know any film TV director who's not a complete control freak. And I think what it does, it sort of pushes you where to kind of enjoy a bit of chaos and a bit of things that you actually cannot control. And so, just the fact that we started filming in winter and we went through summer. And since we weren't since we were kind of doing from all episodes, and the episode kind of goes from winter to summer, you know, some of the things that we filmed in the beginning where it was winter kind of obviously gave us some challenges that we didn't, but also because of that gave us some weird, surprising things. I know you are looking for a concrete example. I can't think of one right now. I just know there are lots of them.
Yeah, no, it's hard to remember. Also, you know, in terms of the setting of the show and that very specific location of kind of a wealthy Upper West Side space of town, it's so interesting because it's not something where these people see each other every morning as they're taking their kids to school, because they're not necessarily living right next door to the front door of their neighbors. Did you find yourself really leaning into that aspect of how all of these characters and all of these relationships would always have had a sense of mystery with each other?
Yeah. And I think what I was also leaning into that I've always perceived that world as being quite mysterious. I've always kind of, you know, you walk in those streets and you look at those perfect little kids being ushered into perfect limousines and by a nanny, and you kind of go, woo, what is this world? I mean, what is the actual reality of that world? I mean, you know, because everything which is there is an image. It's so much an image. And I don't think in any other, I can't think of maybe, you know, maybe a royal household or but I can't really think of any other sort of environment which is so much about, you know, an outside image and a complete a closed wall to what is actually going on. And I just thought that was such a fantastic thing to be able to portray and fantasize about and actually venture into in a weird way.
Mm-hmm. And I wanted to dive into talking about the final episode, because within that court scene, there's so much that happens with these characters that is never said out loud. There's no dialogue. There's a lot of moments where you're really panning the camera over within those court sequences. So what was the journey and the challenges of shooting such monumental scenes for the show and really, you know, having to find different visual tools without being able to rely on dialogue to have so much of a journey of what these characters are thinking and doing and the games that they're playing with each other?
You know, I always love courtroom dramas, but then with this script, you know, I was kind of, okay, here you are, you're going to do a courtroom drama, and I just wanted to do it in a different way. I just wanted to do it so it was more kind of, I want to say, seductive than, you know, it was less about the words and more about the emotional space between the characters. And so it was a lot. I mean, you know, it was also like lenses and sort of looking slightly almost into the camera at times. Like, you know, it was being very meticulous about every single moment and being very meticulous about every single moment being covered in a very emotional way. And also, you know, it was tricky because it's quite a complicated conceit. And what Grace does is a very complicated conceit. And because it happens in real time, because we are experiencing it while Grace does it. And a lot of storytelling is suspense. And like there's a lot of storytelling where you kind of know more as an audience than the characters within the scene. And here we don't. And yet we needed to understand it. And we needed to understand that what Grace does in the last episode is a very conscious, like carefully planned thing. And that was very, very, very tricky, getting, you know, not revealing anything and yet being sure that, like, there could be no doubt that it was a plan.
Yeah.
And it was like, whoa. I mean, I want to say that one last courtroom scene kept me awake many nights, because that's a very, very, very difficult thing to tell.
It's also great because, you know, it's one of the first few moments that Jonathan is suddenly completely pushed up against a wall and has no way out. And particularly in the court scene, he's in front of a crowd of people and there's nowhere that he can turn where people aren't going to see exactly what he's thinking plastered all over his face. Did the two of you think about whether he was still going to try to and manage to mask it a little bit, or that it was going to completely slip off in that moment? Did you try different versions of it at all?
We didn't try distinctly different. I mean, he gets up and he says, it's a lie. I mean, he kind of sort of, and at that point, he's obviously lost it. But until that point, I mean, I think the kind of, you know, the careful dance was sort of when in her, and also in Noma, like in his lawyer, like when do they realize that Grace had kind of played a game with them. At what point, and it kind of comes gradually, like, you know, in the beginning, like, oh, okay, she made a mistake. That was not great, but, you know, we're fine. And then it kind of grows and grows. And now the prosecutor knows things that there is no way she could have known. And Grace is volunteering. And I think sort of little by little, it dawns on them. And they are completely, I mean, Jonathan certainly loses it. Haley doesn't, because Haley is a professional, yeah. But she does anyway.
And that moment that you really cement it for the audience is as Grace is walking out and she gives Lily Rabe's character just that one singular tiny glance. Was that something that David had written into the scripts, or was that something that you decided together on set as just kind of like that final nail in the coffin and kind of like give over to the audience of like, yes, she planned this all along?
You know, it was certainly something David and I had a lot of conversations about, because it was obviously for both of us a concern about, you know, do we understand it? When do we understand it? How do we do it? And I'm sure that in the script there were like, I can't remember what kind of glances there were in the script, but you know, there were, but essentially, I think both David and I knew that there was no way of actually controlling this until editing. Because mm-hmm. it's like, you shoot everything you need and you shoot the glances, and then you have to deal with it and edit and kind of make sure that, again, you tell what you need to tell, but you don't tell more than you have to, because then it kind of dies.
Yeah. And in working with Hugh overall, you know, he just like comes up with the most meticulous level of detail for every character that he develops and loves to really dissect every single line and every single moment. And did you find that particularly for that scene, because there's so many wavelengths that Jonathan's going on, that you had a lot more conversation about a lot of the unsaid details with each other?
I mean, Hugh is a sort of he's notoriously worried. So we would finish a scene and he would go, I don't think we have it. And I would go, yeah, I actually think we do. And with that scene, he was like, I don't think we have it. And I think we do. And I have to, admittedly, I was saying to myself, I hope we do.
So your job as a director to make everybody feel like everything's great all the time. And then I wanted to talk about the scene where Jonathan has his son in the car, because I love the way that jump cuts back and forth between, you know, he's singing a song to his son at the same time that we're seeing finally what he actually did.
That's you improvising.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's really phenomenal. And then the way that you edited that together, just those juxtapositions of tones that brings and the way that plays with your emotions as an audience is so brilliant. And it really is such a highlight of like his level of deception. Like that's how far he can take it even with his own son. Did you always know that you were going to be jumping back and forth between those two moments in that way? Yeah. Or was that very much a discovery in post?
That was a post. But I want to say, here's the thing, that whole scene where they had the final argument and was almost not in the script, but I was like, I think we're going to need it. I think we're going to need the whole thing. So we shot it. And then when we started editing the ending, I was like, okay, this is where this sequence go. And I also think it's so eerie.
It's so eerie. And it's so great because it suddenly pulls together all those moments where he's used his charm. And even then it makes you look back to a lot of his moments with Grace where, you know, that first episode, he doesn't want to go to the fundraiser, but he kind of charms her. And he's like, of course we'll go because you want me to go and this is important to you. Did you kind of really think about the way that his charm was such an effusive effect in the way that he's creating this manipulation and this dominance over her every single moment?
I did, but I want to say that I think part of what Hugh thought was fun was this. Part of what kind of draw him to the part was the kind of, you know, I mean, how often do you get to play a complete psychopath, sociopath, anything path, which kind of contains no excuses in it?
Yeah. Exactly. And then when you're filming that scene on the bridge and we have Grace just running down, I actually wanted to ask about just logistically how that scene came together, because it's really, really remarkable. You have her running down the bridge at the same time that you have a tracking shot that's in a close-up on her face the entire time in motion. So how did that come together logistically?
Whoa, you are really perceptive. Well, we just shot that. I mean, we shot all of it. I mean, it was just like, okay, we just need to make sure that we, you know, I think that the trick for me was, okay, it's a kind of a bit of an action kind of scene, but essentially we just need to hold hands with them emotionally, because that's what the whole series have been about. And I didn't want this scene to not be a consequence of everything that has come prior to that. And so yeah, I mean, it was like a kind of handheld on a dolly and handheld behind on it. I mean, it was everything that was sort of a dynamic and moving and yet emotional.
Yeah. And it says so much that then when she walks away with her son at the end, that both of them never turn around to look back at Jonathan.
I'm so glad you said that, because I had huge discussions, because they were, are you sure? And I was less, I'm sure.
So that was the only version that you ever shot?
No, because then the producer said, hey, I think we should do a bit of turning back. And I said, okay, I shoot it, but I just know I'm never going to use it. And I have to say that one of the being an evil director, one of the powers you have is that you can actually shoot something. So it's either going to be used or not used.
And then looking back to when you first came on board on the project, when you first read any of the scripts, you just had the first draft of that first episode from David, you know, and whenever we read a script or any sort of story, you immediately start seeing it as a visual element inside of your mind. When you look at what the show ended up being visually on screen and the way that you concocted that, are there elements that were in your mind already that very first time that you were reading that script?
Her walking at night and the whole sort of New York City. I knew when I read that first script, I was like, I know how I want to portray New York City. I know how I want that to kind of feel.
Yeah. Well, I loved,
it was just like that kind of came eventually. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I loved this show so much. And I hope for anyone watching this conversation, if they haven't already, that they'll go back and rewatch the whole thing, because it's an entirely different experience. Thank you so much, Susanne.
Thank you. Take care.